Let's walk through the life cycle of the live view for our light. When a user initially browses to the light page, a regular HTTP GET request is sent to the server. And we have a live route declared in the router for that. Then, in the light live module, the mount callback is invoked, which assigns the initial state to the socket. Then render is automatically invoked with the state that was assigned to the socket in mount. And a fully rendered HTML page is sent back to the browser as a regular HTTP response. Handling the initial request in this way has a few important benefits. First, the response is super quick. Second, you get a fully rendered, meaningful HTML page, even if JavaScript is disabled in the browser. And so the initial LiveView page is search engine friendly.
Nothing too surprising so far, but here's where things get interesting. When the initial page is loaded, it also loads a sliver of JavaScript, it's in app.js, which opens a persistent WebSocket connection to the server. It's at this point that a stateful LiveView process is spawned. Mount is then invoked again, this time inside of the stateful process, and initializes the state of that process by assigning values to the socket. Then, as you probably already guessed, render is also invoked again to render HTML content for that state.
But this time, it's not the raw HTML that's pushed back to the browser over the WebSocket, as you might expect. It's actually something more intriguing and efficient. Let's focus on this section of the Heeks template. Since the assigned brightness value is interpolated twice in this template, we have two dynamic values, values that may or may not have changed. And the rest of the template is static. It will never change. So LiveView splits the template into parts, the stuff that's dynamic and the stuff that's static. Both of the dynamic values evaluate to 10, since that's the initial brightness. You can think of this value as being at position or index 0 of the template, and this value at position or index 1. And all the static and dynamic parts are pushed to the browser over the WebSocket. Then the JavaScript provided by LiveView weaves the static and dynamic parts together.
Splitting the rendered content into static and dynamic parts really pays off when handling events. For example, when we click the button to turn the light on, an on event is pushed down the WebSocket to the LiveView process and gets handled by a matching handle event callback. A brightness of 100 is assigned to the socket, and whenever a LiveView state changes, the render function is automatically called. Since handling the on event only changed the brightness value, setting it to 100, only these template expressions need to be evaluated. If the LiveView had other pieces of state rendered by the template, they would only be evaluated if they changed when the light was turned on.
That's pretty clever. It doesn't have to reevaluate all the Elixir expressions in the template, only the ones for things that changed. So what's sent to the browser this time? Well, the static parts aren't sent again. They're already cached in the browser. Only the dynamic values that changed, or the diffs, get sent. So as before, all the LiveView.js needs to do is zip the static and dynamic parts together. And then it uses the morph.dom library to efficiently patch the DOM to turn the light on.
So what happens if we click the on button again? Well, an on event is pushed down the WebSocket, the handle event callback assigns a brightness of 100, and render is invoked. And there's another advantage of a Heeks template. It tracks changes to the state and knows that the brightness value hasn't actually changed. It was 100 before, and it's 100 now, so there's no need to send new dynamic values to the browser. And so the response has no static or dynamic parts.
Now if we click the off button, an off event is sent and handled, which sets the brightness to 0, and render is invoked. And since the Heeks template is tracking changes to state, it recognizes that the brightness changed. So all it sends back to the browser are the diffs.
Nice!
So let's see this lifecycle in action, starting with what happens on the server side.
Back in our LiveView module, Light Live, let's add some logging to the lifecycle callbacks. First in mount, use IO inspect, and we'll log the process ID that mount is invoked in, so that's just self, and we'll give it a label of mount. Then we'll do the same thing in render, just copy this. This will be render. And also in the handle event for on. Then we'll open the Phoenix server log next to the browser, and we'll put a bunch of blank space to start with a clean slate. So now if we reload over here, we see the initial GET request to slash light, and then mount and render are invoked inside the process with the PID 2118. And that sends back a fully rendered HTML page. Then the browser opens a WebSocket connection, and we see that happening here. And after connecting, a stateful LiveView process is spawned. And mount and render are invoked again, this time inside of that process, 2137. So then over here, if we click the on button, an on event is pushed down the WebSocket and gets handled in that same process, 2137. And then render is also invoked in that same process. And this stateful live view process, number 2137, stays alive as long as we stay connected.
Yeah, but what happens if something goes haywire? Like, suppose an exception is raised when handling the on event.
Let's simulate that. We'll use raise with a little fireball. And the browser reloads because we've changed the code, and our current live view process is now 2181. And now if we click the on button, scroll back up here. Well, we see that the on button was handled, but an exception was raised, and the live view process crashed. But we don't see an exception over here in the browser. Instead, the light meter simply resets to the initial state of 10%. That's because if we scroll down here, we see that a new live view process was automatically spawned, 2189, and in the browser, we're automatically connected to that new process. Super cool.
So now let's take out this exception and see what's happening in the client or the browser during the lifecycle.
And we'll do that by opening the browser's developer tools, and we're on the network tab, and we're only interested in JS, doc, and WebSocket traffic. So I'll close that filter and then reload the page to start recording network activity.
Right, so it's as if we're browsing to /light for the very first time.
Yeah, and first it sends a regular HTTP GET request to /light. And we know on the server, the Light Live module's mount and render callbacks are invoked. And a fully rendered HTML page is sent back, and we see that in the response tab. And if we scroll down, we see the content rendered by our LiveView template. So right here is the H1, front porch light, the light meter, and four buttons.
So where did all this other HTML come from? Well, live views are always rendered within a layout, and a layout is just a Heeks template that wraps content rendered by another Heeks template.
The layout templates are in the LiveView Studio Web Components Layouts directory, and we see it includes two layout templates, app and root. And those were generated for us.
And you'll notice that both of these files have the .heex extension, which means these are Heeks templates in and of themselves.
Now, root is the outermost layout, so let's pop it open. It has all the standard HTML stuff, the head with some meta tags. This getCSRF token generates a meta tag for the CSRF token, for example. Then we've got this page title, we'll come back to it later, a link to our CSS file, and this script tag loads assets /app.js. And then the body has this inner content, which gets replaced by what's in the app template. It has a main tag, and this generates any flash messages. And then this inner content gets replaced by what's in the LiveView's render function. So light live, it's render function here. So back in the response tab, that's where all this extra HTML comes from. The root layout stuff all the way up to the body. Then the app layout gets rendered inside of a special div. You notice it has the attributes data.phx_main and data.phx_session. It has the encoded session data and any flash messages. And then the HTML rendered by the live view.
Now the browser also loads this app.js script.
That file is in the assets JS directory, app.js. And it starts with some imports. It imports socket from the Phoenix JS library. Then it imports live socket from the Phoenix LiveView JS library. And also imports the top bar library for showing a progress bar while users interact with the app. Then it scoops up the CSRF token in that meta tag. And then it initializes a new live socket with the /live endpoint, the socket, and then params, which includes the CSRF token. And then it sets up some event listeners for showing the progress bar when appropriate. And finally, it calls connect on that LiveSocket instance to establish a WebSocket connection with the server. And if we go back to the browser, we see two WebSocket connections. One has a CSRF token and one doesn't. And the one without the token is for live reloading in development. So we want to look at the one with the CSRF token. And in the Headers tab, notice it's connected to the slash live endpoint.
Okay, so now the browser and server can send messages back and forth over this connection. And we see those messages in the Messages tab. Let's scroll up past all these automatic heartbeat messages that keep the connection alive, and we see the first message that was sent. It's this PHX join message in green, which indicates that it's an outbound message.
So this message is an array of elements, and they're all broken out. The first one is a join ref, and it's 4. The second one is a message ref, and it's also 4, but don't worry about those two elements. The third one is a PHX channel topic, so it's LV, PHX, and then some unique ID. And that's because each live view connects to a unique Phoenix channel. And then the fourth one is the actual event, PHX join. And then we have the payload, which is a JavaScript object, which includes params with a CSRF token, and also the session data.
So the result of sending this message is the LiveView joins a Phoenix channel and a stateful LiveView process is spawned. And we know that mount and render are called again, this time inside that process. Then we get this incoming PHX reply message in red, which indicates it's an inbound message.
And it includes a response, which is a JavaScript object with a rendered property that has 5 keys. 0 through 3 and S. And these first 3 keys, 0, 1, and 2, are dynamic values that come from the app layout template and have to do with flash messages. And this stuff in 3 looks familiar. These are the two dynamic values at position 0 and 1, and they're both set to 10, which is the initial brightness of the light. Then under this S key, we have the static parts of the LiveView's Heeks template. So we have 3 strings under the keys 0, 1, and 2. And notice these static parts are split around the dynamic parts. So the first part starts with an H1 and includes everything up to width, right there. And between that part and the next one, which starts with percent, comes dynamic part 0. And that makes sense because if we look at the template, after width comes this dynamic brightness value. And then we should expect to see a static part, this percent and the closing tag here, followed by another dynamic part, and all the rest is static HTML. And indeed, that's exactly what we see. Static part 1 is percent and a closing tag, then our dynamic value of 10 again, and then the rest of this is static HTML. So when the LiveView.js weaves this together, it goes static 0, dynamic 0, static 1, dynamic 1, and then static 2. And then back at the top level, you'll notice there's also an S key. And this has the static parts of the app layout.
Okay, so now let's bump the brightness by 10. And scroll down past all these heartbeats, we see an up event is pushed down to the WebSocket. And that's handled by the handle event callback, and the brightness is updated to 20. Then render is automatically called, and the changes are pushed back to the browser, and they're in this incoming PHX reply message.
Yeah, and if we look at the response under diff, it just has the new dynamic values that changed, 20 and 20. There's no need to send the static parts since they're already cached in the browser. So the payload sent over the wire, the WebSocket, is as minimal as possible, and the LiveView JavaScript takes care of patching the DOM with the changed values.
So hopefully this gives you a better and deeper understanding of the life cycle of a LiveView. Now, let's go build another one.